I would like to introduce you all to Sandy.
Hi, guys.
Thank you.
I'm sure everyone's read the little bio that I put together. She's kind of a really cool lady. And, she's a film school dropout that's gone on to be, an Oscar-nominated editor and one of the most fabulous people I've had the pleasure to meet. And so I'm really excited to kind of bring her to you guys and give the opportunity to get to know her a little bit as well. And a little bit about, her and how she works and what some of the amazing things that she's done. But I think, a lot of the really cool thing about Sandy is that she has the most amazing stories to tell. So I just, the thing that I'm most excited about is that really you guys get to hear some of them too. Because we sit across the lunch table and she tells these stories and I'm sitting there just going, wow, this is so cool. So
I was going to start off by telling you that that where the role of editor originated, which you might not know, because it goes back to ancient Rome. I doubt that many of you would have had any awareness of that. But back in ancient Rome, whenever there would be a conquering hero, he would come back to the city, and they would have a huge parade for him with people lining the streets, and he would be riding through the streets in a chariot. And as he rode through the streets in a chariot, there was a slave who was assigned to ride behind him and keep whispering into his ear, homo es, meaning you are only a man, so that he wouldn't be overwhelmed by all of this adulation he was getting. Well, that role through the ages has come down to the film editor. Because while the director is being told over and over again how wonderful he is, especially on the set, is being told how fantastic the dailies are and how fantastic the performances are. The editor is the one who has to, at a daily screening, if there are daily screenings anymore, but in watching the dailies, has to be able to sit there and say, there's a little bit more work that has to be done. And nobody else takes on that role. So that's what we as editors are being forced to do. Yeah. So. Anyway,
wow, and
that's the history part of it. I was a history major. What do you want?
That's right. I mean, Sandy was a history major and then ended up going to NYU because she was too shy to be a teacher. But not long after being at NYU, I mean, you got your first internship because you saw a notice on a notice board.
Yeah, and everybody else stood around gawking at it, saying, oh my God, one of the teachers actually just shot a film and needs some help in the cutting room. And everybody else is standing there just like looking at it and saying, wow, that's really cool. And so my best friend at film school at that moment, and I, Kevin, and I walked across the lobby to the teacher's office and knocked on the door. And so who got the job, right? The people who were gawking or the person who just bothered to walk across. And the reason I got the job over Kevin was that I already had a reputation for getting to places on time and turning in papers on time and whatever was required. I was known as responsible. And Kevin didn't have quite that rep, so that's how I got the job. But it was an extraordinary experience because it was like any other internship. You were asked to pick up coffee for people, you were asked just to put things away, neaten up the room, so forth and so on. But they didn't have any money. It was a very low budget project. It was for PBS. And so amongst the early things that I was asked to do was to pick out sound effects for them. They had a couple of sound effects that they knew that they needed. And when they told me what sound effects they wanted, I'd been listening to the film as they were putting it together and I was thinking, well, yeah, I know you need those things, but you also need this, 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 and this. So I said that to them. I said, if I'm going someplace to pick up the sound effects, shall I also ask for the other things that are lacking? And they looked at me like, say what? And I said, well, it seems to me that you need whatever the heck. You need a siren here. You need a crash here. You need a traffic jam, so forth and so on. Various things that came up in the story. And so they said, why don't you just make a list of what you think we need? So I made them a list, and they looked at it, and they said, yeah, those are the things we need. yeah, why don't you go and pick up those sound effects? And then when I got back, they had me cut them in. So it was not all of them, I mean, but it was still the sort of thing where it was astounding. You just, you know, if you brought it up, chances were fairly decent that you were going to be asked to do the next step, which I think happens a lot in cutting rooms. That's certainly happening in our cutting room. Bree, who is our intern, brings things up, and she gets to do them, too. So
there she is up back. Yeah. There she's doing sound for us this evening. Exactly. She really does everything.
Yeah, she does. Yeah. She does a little bit of everything. She's jack of all trades.
Yeah. And then I think one of my favorite stories that you've told me is about how when you're in the middle of all your student projects, and it was April 1st.
Oh, right.
And, yeah.
Okay. When I was at film school, one of the first things that everybody, well, apart from a relatively short project that we did to music, where we shot something MOS, but against a song of our choice. After that project, we did our first project with sound, and you know everybody was shooting their, I don't know how long these films were, you know, 5 to 10 minutes tops. I mean, it was nothing of any duration, but our month of production was the month of March. And everybody was totally exhausted because all of us were trying to do far more than we had the time to do. And everybody was
taking
yeah, exactly. And everybody was taking on a bunch of different roles on other people's films. Although we were generally in 3-person crews, you would work on other people's crews as well. So you were always working around the clock. And I was totally exhausted by the end of that month. So I was going to sleep in on what was the next day, which was April 1st, not surprisingly, after the month of March, April 1st usually comes up. But so I was sleeping in, it was a weekday, and I was just totally knocked out, and the phone rang and woke me up, and I picked up the line, and the voice on the other end of the line said, hi, is this Sandy Morse? And I said, yes. And he said, well, this is Ralph Rosenblum. I'd like to talk to you about a job possibility. And I said, yeah, right. And I just hung up the phone because I just assumed it was one of my friends playing an April Fool's joke, and I was in no mood for this. And about an hour or two later, I got another call, and the fellow said, hello, is this Sandy Morse? And I said, yes. And he said, well, this is Ralph Rosenblum, and I really would like to talk to you about a job possibility. And I said, oh, thank you. I'm sorry. Sorry, I hung up before. And he said, do you think you'd be available to come in and talk to me about it for an interview on Tuesday, say at 2 o'clock, something like that? And I said, oh, you know, I would so love to do this. I've heard so much about you. It's very flattering for you even to ask me, but actually, Tuesday, I have to act as boom man on a friend's film, and I really can't let him down because it's so difficult to get crew at this point. So I really appreciate it, but I can't make it. And he said, okay. Realize that doesn't necessarily mean the end of the story. What are you doing, say, Thursday morning at 10? I said, I can't believe I have to tell you this, but on Thursday morning at 10, I'm actually acting as the operator on somebody else's film, so I can't really make it then either. He said, okay, let's do it another way. You tell me when you're available, and then we'll see if that works out. And so I gave him some timing or whatever the heck, and I went over to his apartment and was interviewed. And when I got there, quite unlike what I had imagined a standard interview would be, he asked me if I'd like a cup of coffee, and I thought it was supposed to go the other way around. But in any case, I said yes. And he went off to get the coffee from some other room. He was his apartment. He worked and lived in a brownstone, so his cutting room was in a brownstone. And he went upstairs to his apartment to get the coffee for me, and I'm sitting there in his cutting room and looking at what's on his wall, and there's a mask. He had been Woody's editor for a long time at that point, and there was a mask for Sleeper up on the wall, and there were photographs of him with a bunch of different celebrities that he'd worked with on a bunch of different films. He'd done Long Day's Journey into Night, he'd done The Pawnbroker with Rod Steiger, and so forth. There were a lot of things that he had done that were pretty notable, and there was another thing called the Golden Scissors Award, which I'd never heard of, but sounded kind of important for A Thousand Clowns. Anyway, so when he came back, he sat down and gave me my coffee, which was very nice of him. And then he asked me where I'd gone to school. I mean, obviously I was at NYU graduate school at that moment, but he asked me where I'd gone to college, and I said, sort of shyly, because this never went over well in normal conversation, I said, I went to Yale, and sort of swallowed it as best I could so that I didn't have to really have this conversation, because a lot of people at that point, since it was still pretty unusual for women to be going to that school, and I didn't really want to get into this whole conversation about that. He said, well, I just want you to know that intimidates me. And I said, hold on a second. That intimidates you. And just for a moment, turn around and look at that wall behind you. There's this, you know, mask from Sleeper. There are these photographs of you with a whole bunch of celebrities. There's this Golden Scissors Award. You know, who should be intimidated by whom in this situation? And that broke the ice, and we became the best of friends.
And we've actually got a picture of
that cutting room.
You can see her up there.
There I am.
That's Sandy doing her with her first assistant editor gig.
Yeah.
At the back.
That's me. And this is the sofa on which I was sitting, and he was here on this desk
right here.
Wow.
Yeah.
In any case.
And this is the moviola, right?
The moviola is back there, and this is the Steenbeck that we used mostly at that point for screening. As I was saying to Katie earlier, neither of these guys knew how to operate the Steenbeck, so there was a point to my being in the room.
And you were, what are you splicing trims back together there at the back, probably?
At that particular moment, I'm probably what Ralph would do when he would cut on the moviola. Which may or may not be something that you guys have ever heard of, because he was really old school. He used to cut things on the moviola, but he would never splice them together. He would paperclip them together, and then he would hand me the film, and I would take the paperclips off and actually make the splices. So he never actually saw his splices, his cuts, until he had cut it together, which is kind of pretty amazing. Always kind of stunning to me, but that's the way people used to do it.
That's
that
cool. Isn't that cool, right?
Yeah.
So I guess Ralph was kind of your mentor, right? He was definitely.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I had worked on a prior film, the first film that I was describing to you that I worked on as an intern, but after that it was the editor of that film who recommended me to Ralph, who then called me. So Ralph was the first person for whom I worked for actual pay, as opposed to the coffee every now and then that I would get on the other project. But yes, I made $69 take home on that per week. Mm-hmm. That was the first person that I worked for, and we did several projects before I would have gone back to film school the following September, The following September, as I say, sort of the end of August, I got a phone call from Ralph saying, would I like to work on this next project, because he was working on a series of short projects before then. And on that next project, I had the option of going back to film school and paying for my education, or going to work for him and being paid for my education. So I opted for being paid for my education.
And that was Annie Hall.
And that was Annie Hall, yeah.
Yeah.
At that point, that was untitled, is what that was at that point. Temporarily Anhedonia was the...
And of course, there's the story that you've told me before. One of the first things that I heard about you was that when you got a chance to show Woody a cut...
Oh, that wasn't Annie Hall. That was Interiors, but sure.
That was pretty early on.
Yeah, that was pretty early on. And the Annie Hall story was not the story that you're referring to, but the Annie Hall story was that at the end of the film, they were talking about putting together that memory montage, which, if you've seen Annie Hall, is, you know, the penultimate moment when they're sort of going back over what their relationship had been, and reprising Seems Like Old Times, which is the song that Diane Keaton had sung in when she was performing for the first time. Or not for the first time, performing for the first time and feeling okay about her performance. But in any case, when they were talking about what they wanted to do and putting together that memory montage, which was not a scripted notion, that was something that Ralph had suggested because he had done something similar in Goodbye Columbus, which I have to admit that I have yet to see. So my apologies for not really knowing what that reference is. But in any case, as they were talking about what they were imagining doing, I just went to the closet where all the trims were and pulled out the things that I thought would be useful for that montage. And so when Ralph turned to me and said, "We're talking about putting together a montage of memories," I said, "Yes, I was listening, and these are the trims that occurred to me that would be helpful to you, and here's a list of what they are. Let me know of anything else that you'd like." But they just took things from that box. And that was that. So that was kind of a cool moment. But on the next project with Woody was interiors. And when Ralph first saw the script for that, he was not impressed. He was anticipating that Woody would do another comedy, and it would be, since Annie Hall had actually done rather well. Obviously, you guys are too young to know this, but at the time of it was Woody was not really taken seriously as a director at all. He had done a series of films that were popular in sort of a niche audience, but not popular in a large audience. And this was a low-budget project for the time. It was a $2 million film, and at the time, that was a low-budget project. And so nobody anticipated it's making that much money or making much of a splash. He did hire Gordon Willis to be his cinematographer on that, thinking that Gordy would make the look of the thing much more, not exactly formal, but much more presentable than the prior films that he had done. Much more professional, I guess, is the term I'm reaching for. And he had ideas about how he wanted it to look, that he wanted the California material to look washed out, and he wanted the New York material to have a romantic kind of quality to it in terms of the color and so forth. And so Gordon would be a big part of that. But basically, the film did much better than anybody ever imagined it would do. It immediately got a lot of attention in terms of Woody being written up on the cover of Time magazine, for example, as a comic genius, which was news to him at that point. But in any case, but in addition to that, it was nominated for 4 Academy Awards for Best Picture, for Best Screenwriter, for probably Original Screenwriter, for Best Actress in Diane Keaton. Come on, you can do this. You can do this. I think it might have even been for Best Actor for Woody. I can't actually swear to that, but I think that was the fourth one. But in any case, and it won 3 out of 4. So it was a big deal, and it was a huge change. It was like the apotheosis of Woody Allen as an artist. Suddenly he was an artist. Before that, he'd been a comic. So therefore Ralph did not imagine by any stretch of the imagination that the next script he was going to get from him was a serious film that didn't even seem like it read all that desperately well or was going to be that effective. So he thought he was really going out on a limb and that it was a big mistake. I didn't have all that different an opinion of the script, but my opinion was, boy, that's really great that he's going to be that courageous to try something that he wants to try, and more power to him. I want this to work out for him. I want it to be successful. Ralph went to Woody and said, Ralph was at that point interested in becoming a director, and he had a project that he was wanting to develop, so he asked Woody if it would be all right with him if Ralph and I split the editing, if he would cut the first scene, I would cut the second scene, he would cut the third scene, and so forth. So this brings us to the actual question that was asked of me. Yes, that was a long preamble, but the actual question was, what was the first thing, what was it like when I presented the first thing I ever cut to Woody? And it was absolutely fantastic. It was an exciting moment. I cut the thing. I had to cut it on a Moviola as opposed to that Steinbeck you saw, which was the thing I was more comfortable cutting on. But I cut it on a Moviola because that's what Ralph had in the room, or that's what he gave me to cut it on. And when I spliced it together, having cut all the pieces together, there were several things that were amiss. One of them was that it was shot by Gordon Willis, and there was a lot of the shots were very dark, and the frame line was very much almost identical to the mullion lines in the windows in the scene. So I managed to cut not on the frame line, but on one of the mullions instead. So one of the shots that I cut in was out of frame by a sprocket. That was not my favorite moment. But there was, we had also, back in those days, the way you kept things in sync was with a coating that was on the side of the film at foot intervals, at 1 foot intervals. So every 16 frames, you would have another ink coating number on the side of the film. When the coating didn't come through properly, what you would do would be you would go through and just recode on the same frame, but you'd put X's, and so that it would be blocked out. They called it block out coding, surprisingly. And then you'd code it again like four frames away from that so that the next set of codes would be actually legible. Well, I misread one of the block out codes as being the actual code, so I also had another shot that was out of sync totally. And then just for good measure, I also had a shot that was upside down. So I put it up on the Steenbeck so that we could watch it, and you know, the first thing that came up was probably the thing that was out of frame, and I'm going, oh God. And I reached out to stop the thing, and Woody just grabbed my arm and said, no, let's watch it. And I went on, and the next thing was out of sync, and the next thing was upside down, and I'm sitting there just dying. and at the end of it, Woody just took a nice pause, and I said, I'm not sure I can assess it in this form. And then I put it together the way it was supposed to be put together, and he was fine with that. But it was the perfect baptism of fire. But I say that, I usually tell my assistants that relatively early on a project so that they realize that I'm not really going to be all over you if you make a mistake. It's like, I know that people make mistakes, and I'm really good at making mistakes. So don't be too hard on yourself. Everybody makes mistakes.
And of course, pretty early on, it was like right after you just finished Manhattan, I believe, that you also got a really cool chance to do some work on Raging Bull with Thelma Schoonmaker.
Yeah. Well, Thelma and I were friends. I had met her via a mutual friend who was another assistant on Interiors, who was the other assistant on Interiors. I was officially an assistant, although I did half of the cutting. But Sonia Polonsky, who's a fantastic assistant, and I was so thrilled to work with her. When I met her, I thought we were the same age because she looked so young, you know, and whatever. And I learned that she was 10 years older than I, and it never occurred to me. But in any case, she was very good friends with Thelma. They were particularly close, and she had worked on Woodstock with Thelma and Marty and Tina Hirsch, I guess, was on it as well. I'm trying to think of who all was on that, but a lot of notable editors were involved in that project. So I got to know Thelma through Sonia, and we used to go out to dinner all the time together and whatever. So,
as you do. I mean, really.
Yeah. Well, yeah, I mean, all the time, as though we ever went out to dinner, as though we ever got out of the cutting room. But whenever we were out of the cutting room, we would go out to dinner together. And but when she, therefore, when Thelma was working on Raging Bull, she was not yet a member of one of the unions. Back then, LA and New York were two separate unions, and you were in one or the other, and the two were very much, it was like the Hatfield and McCoy, if you know that reference, you history majors. It was like the Palestinians and the Israelis. It was definitely not, you know, we were definitely not friends with each other, and therefore, whenever she was working in one, and not therefore, but if you were a New York member, you wouldn't be permitted to work in LA and vice versa. Well, she was from neither. She was from San Francisco at the time, and she's actually born in Aruba to make it all a little bit more obscure. But in any case, so she would, whenever she was in LA, have to have what they'd call a standby editor, who was just somebody who was an LA editor on the project as well, who would have to get paid as an editor because she was working and she was not allowed to. And the same thing would happen in New York. generally speaking, when she got these standby editors, they were just happy to take the paycheck and weren't willing to do very much. And when on one occasion she was in New York and needing a standby editor, she called and asked for the list of who was not working at that moment, and I wasn't working, so she called me up and said, hey, would you like to come over and work with me for whatever it was, a month or a month and a half, whatever it required, while De Niro was putting on weight, which is why there was a lot of different places where she was editing. And so at that point, I'd say, of course, I'd do it, but the fun of that for me was just to be working with them, having the opportunity to cut with Marty to a meager degree. I would be cutting on one chem while she was cutting on another, but I would be cutting with Marty, acting as my assistant as I was cutting, so because he was an editor as well, and so he didn't, you know. So he had no problem with that, but he just, you know, wanted to be over my shoulder because he didn't know what to expect from me. And Thelma would go off and do her stuff. Or I would just do sound editing for them or whatever was required. I'd be perfectly happy to put away trims or whatever to help my friend Sonia, who was the first assistant on that, because I loved her and I loved Thelma, and I was happy to do whatever was required. And it was a fantastic experience. And and Thelma actually, when she got her Academy Award for that, pointedly thanked Sonia, probably first amongst the people she thanked. I mean, even probably before Marty, she knew how tough it had been on Sonia, not least of all because she kept having to have people in the cutting room who were doing no work and everything was on her shoulders. Mm-hmm. So
I think that's very, very cool that she wanted to thank her assistant. I think it's cool. And I mean, and of course when you got your Muse Award, thanked every assistant that you had ever had up to that point. Literally, she did that. I think that's really, really cool. I guess because you worked as an assistant, and I think, you know, potentially some of your experiences kind of, you know, influenced your, you know, the way that you are and the way that you are in the cutting room and the way that you respect the people that are around you and you give them a voice.
I think that actually derives to an extent from having played team sports a lot. You're right too. But I mean, from having played team sports a lot, I always felt as though it didn't matter who put the ball through the goalposts or through the basket or whatever the heck. It didn't matter. It was everybody on the team was a contributing factor to a victory or a loss, but generally speaking, to any success, everybody was a factor in it, and you were only a good team if everybody was involved in it, and I feel the same way. I've always said editing was a team sport, but yes, I definitely have felt throughout the entire time I've been working that I wanted my assistants to be involved. I wanted my assistants' opinions of things. I don't want anybody not to speak up if they. This is Trish over here, who is my current assistant, and I don't.
Trisha, stand up.
Come on. We're actually going to bring Trisha up very soon to talk a little bit about you and her and how you guys work together.
But I do want other people's opinions, and I think that's the only way anything good comes of a project, if you're getting outside opinions. And I think I do think that the assistant is part of the reason that anything works out, is if you have a good assistant behind you. But yes, I did ask for their names to be on the screen, so there was like a crawl of all the assistants I had up until that point.
Mm. Well, Trisha, there's a chair over there and a mic that you just need to turn on. I think everyone should meet Trisha. She's Sandy's assistant right now.
And she's terrific. Mm-hmm.
Likewise. I think it's on. Maybe.
Are we going, Bray? We got some sound for Trish?
Maybe not. Yes.
Yeah, we do. Right. Cool.
Cool.
Well, just to put Trish on the spot, just to make her really kind of embarrassed, Sandy, what is it that you look for in an AE?
I look for somebody who's intelligent. I look for somebody who is willing, who is honest, and who is willing to speak up about anything, and not going to be cowed by my disagreeing with her about something. I look for somebody who knows the avid inside out, if that's what we're working on, or final cut, if that's what we're working on, so that I can feel totally comfortable that if I'm not savvy on all the under the hood stuff, that somebody can have my back. But primarily, I'm looking for a partner, is the way I look at it. So.
So
somebody who organizes things well.
Well, that's always important for any AE, I think, to be very organized. I think, you know, some people on Facebook prior to this were asking some more kind of technical questions, and one in particular was like on day one, what is the thing? And I kind of want to ask both of you, on day one of any project, when you come in, what is the first thing that is your priority that you wanted that you do? Like, where do you start? And let's start with you, Trish, because you probably actually have a lot to do on day one.
Yeah, definitely. Day one is very busy, setting up not only our room in terms of our desk, the chair that you may or may not want. Actually, you bring your own chair with you.
And you have a standing desk.
But also, you know, I'm creating our Avid project, which is just a series of setting, you know, puts or whatever. But also, you know, making sure our shared storage is working and set up the way that, in this case, actually, I brought something that, you know, I have a certain way that I like to set up the back end of, like, Avid and all of that storage, and I asked Sandy what she likes to do, and she was very accommodating and, you know, wanted to know what was easiest for me, what she prefers, and where we could find a common ground, which was really, really very nice. And then we jumped right into, like, creating the scene, wall chart, I guess, which is sort of essentially like a scene board.
We're going to have to go into that at some point, because you have a very unique way.
Definitely. That also involves like a file maker document of, you know, condensing the script into very short descriptions of each scene and just color coding and dots and what, you know, all that kind of thing.
And Sandy, what is it that you do on the first day?
Well, the wall chart is very important to me, because I feel as though that's part of the way I get used to what the order, the continuity of the film is, and it's something that I always reference as we're working. It also helps you memorize the order of scenes if the wall chart is actually complete ahead of time. But I also like to make sure that we didn't have that luck on this particular project, but I'd like to make sure in general that I go through the script and make a list of all these sound effects that might be critical in different scenes in the film, because I would rather have them available to me as I go through rather than having to go find them after the fact, because I just don't like to have to wait for things once I get to a point where I think this would be helpful for one reason or another. And I like to just go through the script a series of times and really feel comfortable especially with what's coming up next. But I like to have discussed it with the director in advance and find out what their intentions are. But for sure, I also want to know what's going on that coming week and anything that I think I can mention that would be useful for them to make sure that they get that might not be obvious. Because it's always frustrating when they're shooting and you realize that they didn't even occur to them that they might need such and such an angle. It's nicer to have discussed it up front.
Can you give us a quick description or a rundown without getting too technical into the wall chart? Like, unfortunately, I don't think we have a picture of a wall chart of yours, but Sandy has this. You know, there's all these different people who put, like, pictures on the wall, like Walter Murch has his, you know, still of every shot in the movie. Sandy has her own very unique and complex system of a wall chart that one person has to learn what that is and manage it, so.
It's not really that complicated at all. It really isn't. If you think about, if you've seen the strip board that the assistant director would have on the set, have you seen those things? They're black things that are accordion-like, but in any case, there's a series of strips of different colors having different significance to each color. But the idea of it, as much as anything, is if we suddenly have a problem with the weather or whatever the heck, and everything has to be shot in a different order, you can pull the strips off and put them someplace else. But they all just, like, slip in at two ends, right? That's the concept of them. So rather than having a vertical thing like that, I have a horizontal strip board that's on the wall in sort of rails on either side, which I picked up at Home Depot. Nothing's too different. But with slats that are about an inch and a half tall per slat, and each one of those slats represents a scene. So what happens then is as you go through the film, if you delete something, if you lift something, you just pull it out of the thing, and everything else just slides up or down to move it into the proper place. But if you totally reorder scenes, it's not as though you have to move a bunch of cards individually and move every single card in order to get everything into order again. You just pull this from over here and you put it over there instead. And it's nice because all of the slats are held on both sides by these rails I'm trying to describe to you, so that you can just slide 10 scenes at once up or down, depending on how things are reordered. So that's been very useful, and a lot of the directors that I've worked with have found it particularly helpful because you can discuss how you want to reorder the film if you get into that situation where you're totally rejuxtaposing material. You can just do it first on the board, and then having done it on the board and seen whether it seems like it would work, then bother to do it with the actual film.
So
Woody still has one in his cutting room.
That's cool. Mm-hmm. Influenced by you. Mm-hmm. How do you deal with conflict when, I mean, come on, nobody can ever say that there's never conflict in their room. So when that comes up, even if that's with it, there's a difference of opinion, whether somebody's having a rough time, we're in a creative industry, there's always going to be some level of conflict. And as an editor, it's usually your job to deal with that. So how do you deal with it?
So if it's between me and Trish, for example, I'll just send her down to get me a cup of coffee or something.
This kicks me out.
Yeah. I'm joking. If it's between me and the director having different points of view about something, my feeling is, generally speaking, you can always live to fight another day. You know that most things are not a matter of being so critical that you have to win or lose in that particular discussion. Generally speaking, you can give in on whatever the point is, and then come back to it the next time it arises, when you're screening the film, or when somebody else brings up something similar in a screening situation, and they have the same problem. And I also feel, basically, that if you're right about a point, then it's still going to be right the next time it comes up. If you're wrong, you haven't lost anything by giving in. But I do think that most of the time it's a matter of picking your battles and not really fighting about something if you don't think it's really critical. And for the most part, your job as an editor is to a large extent, assuage all of the neuroses and the discomfort of the director who has his or her entire ego and psyche and sense of self-worth on the line, that you want to make the person feel that they're safe in the cutting room and that you are on their side. And then, if you have a difference of opinion, you can generally settle that difference of opinion in a fashion that's amicable. And I've often described it as very much like a marriage in that sense. You're trying to be supportive of the other person, and there are going to be moments where you don't agree about something, but it's usually not something that's a knockdown, drag out fight of any nature. It usually doesn't have to become that. So
what do you do when you get stuck?
When you get stuck, you try to think of it in an entirely different way. Try to let go of all of your preconceptions about something and say, okay, suppose we began it in a different fashion. Suppose we devised an entirely different voiceover for this that's entirely separate from what was devised originally. Let's see whether that works. Or let's see what happens if we put such and such a scene significantly earlier and see how that affects it. Just do something that's dramatic. In a manner of speaking, it's not unlike what Woody would do in directing, which is frequently he would have his actors, if he felt that they were just not getting a scene, he would just say to them, okay, next take, just do it as fast as you possibly can. And they would feel as though they were rushing every line, but what they were actually doing was not being so precious about every line. And then once they let go of things like that, then the next time round, they're better able to listen to the other character and do it more naturally. Sometimes the fastest take is the best. But it's also sort of like, in a sports analogy, if you are having a basketball team that's not playing particularly well, you tell them that they can't dribble at all. Everything has to be passes. And you do that, and suddenly people realize that, oh, yes, we should be moving when we don't have the ball. You know? And there are certain things like that that are just tricks where you just like shake yourself loose of what the preconceptions have been. Doesn't always work, but at least you can try. But basically, the thing is that you don't give up. You know, I differ with Yoda on this thing. I don't feel that it's you do or don't. You know, it's trying doesn't matter. I think trying is often all you can do. You know, but you have to keep trying. You just have to keep banging your head against the wall until you find a better solution. Bang your head against the wall chart. Yeah. That'll work. Well, as I've said frequently also to folks that I work with, my father was in the Marines during World War II, and he went in when he was 38 years old, so I give him an enormous amount of credit for that, because just landing on beachheads when you're 38 years old, that strikes me. It wasn't until I reached 38 that I truly appreciated that. But it's just that he would say you would as a Marine you would land on a beachhead and you wouldn't always have the equipment you wanted, but there it wasn't like you could just call and say, hey, you know, I could really use such and such. You just had to make do with whatever was there, and that's kind of what the situation is in editing all the time. You just have to make do with what you have and keep coming up with another creative way of solving it, and you have to solve it, because on a beachhead it's life or death. In the cutting room, it's not life or death. That's the good part, but
depends on the director.
And that's true. That's true.
So speaking of directors, one thing that kind of fascinates me is that you have, you know, famously worked with both Woody Allen and Louis C.K., mm-hmm. who are both, you know, people who are directors, and they act in their own stuff. And in fact, I mean, Louis cut his own stuff for a bit. How is it?
And is again.
That is again. How is it different navigating, you know, working with a director who's seeing themselves on screen when they're in their own thing? I mean, that must be quite a different experience.
Well, the peculiar thing about both of them is they are capable of looking at themselves as though that were another person, and it's funny also to hear them talk about. When he does that, you know, it's interesting. When he, you mean like when you do that? But they are extraordinarily objective, and I have often felt that it has as much as anything to do in those two instances with the fact that they were both stand-up comics, and they're used to having to look at the situation from the outside, having to look at what they're doing from a very objective point of view, because the audience, things sometimes go over with the audience, and sometimes don't even come close to going over with the audience, and they're having to keep being flexible while they're there and try to find another way of appealing to the audience. And so I think that they're both enormously flexible as they're looking at their own material, and they're not at all precious about it. They're not at all thinking, oh, well, this is the way I wrote it, and therefore this is the way it has to be. Either one of them is absolutely ready to throw anything out on the spur of the moment, and I bet you're going to ask me that other question, right? I'm sorry.
I've got to keep things mysterious for you. I've got to throw you some curveballs to keep on your toes.
Yeah, okay, so when I was working with Louie, there was an occasion on one of the episodes that he had shot, or actually it was a pair of episodes that he had shot with, I don't think that there's anything negative about saying, with Parker Posey. They were called Daddy's Girlfriend 1 and Daddy's Girlfriend 2, where when he came back to the cutting room after having shot them, he said, okay, they're not going to work at all, don't even bother to put them together, total disaster, I'll rewrite them, I'll recast them if I have to, it's just like, it's not going to work. And I said, wait a second, it's like, 1 o'clock in the afternoon. We haven't even got the dailies into the machine yet. You're not going to be able to do anything until tomorrow morning at absolute earliest, and you would have to rewrite something anyway. So why don't I just put them together? Maybe they're better than you thought. You can't tell right now. And you say, no, they're a disaster. It's a waste of your time. I said, well, look at it this way. It's like, I don't have anything else to cut. I've got the rest of the day in front of me. What the heck? I'll just put it together. We'll see what happens. And he said, okay, you can put them together. But we were connected. He had his final cut at his apartment. I had the final cut in the cutting room. He said, you have to press send at 10 o'clock at the absolute outside, and anything past 10 o'clock, I'm not going to look at. So if you send the stuff to me at 10 o'clock, fine. I'll look at it. I'm thinking, oh, great, this is 2 episodes and a half episode, and I haven't even seen the dailies yet. I said, okay, whatever. I said, then I'm just going to use whatever your select take was in what you told the script supervisor, or the last take, and only change it from that if there's a serious problem. And he said, fine. So I put the two together, sent them to him at 10 o'clock on the dot, and Daddy's Girlfriend 1 went out in exactly the form that I ended up cutting it. Daddy's Girlfriend 2 ended up not, we changed that a little bit, but Daddy's Girlfriend 2, ironically, ended up being not only heralded in like Time Magazine's best shows of the year, so as the best comedy, best half hour comedic episode or whatever the heck of the season, but actually winning me an Emmy nomination. So just so I guess
it's
that means that's the essence of, you may as well give it a try, you know. It's like,
yeah, actually
it was funny though. I mean, but it was just him being, you know, it was just an exasperating day for him.
It happens,
absolutely.
You got to keep your cool and do what you think is right, and if it doesn't work, it doesn't work. But hey, you never know, you might get nominated for an Emmy. Okay, so I just want to know, because, you know, I'm a girl, and it always fascinates me, what's it like going to the Oscars? Like, what was it like if she was nominated for an Oscar for Hannah and Her Sisters, and so, you know, What did you wear, and what was it?
I had no idea, and you can probably tell from the fact that I'm wearing a blouse that's like about 20 years old, that I'm not really a clothes horse particularly, but I had no idea, so I asked the costume designers that I knew, since by then I'd worked with several of them, who sent me to Bergdorf Goodman to try stuff on or whatever the heck. And ironically, I met somebody who was from my hometown, who was the dresser in the cutting room. But anyway, so I actually wore a Chanel gown, which was kind of nuts unto itself. But it was one of those things that was going to last forever. Rather than wear the thing that was kind of a little bit more chic and a little bit more, you know, stylish at the time, which would not have lasted one more season. The Chanel gown I've been able to wear for, you know, six or eight occasions. And it's amazing.
Wear it to work occasionally.
To various premieres and so forth since then. But in any case, but that's what I wore. And it did feel to me, because I hadn't gone to my high school prom, it did feel to me like, oh, my high school prom. I get to go to my high school prom, finally. So I had a reason to get dressed up. And it was totally unlike what most people would imagine the experience of going to the Oscars would be. It was the most relaxing experience ever for me, because that was the year that Platoon came out, and Platoon probably doesn't again mean all that desperately much to you, but that year it was the film that everybody had to see, and there were lines around the block, and the only way I actually ever saw it was to wake up early on New Year's Day, so I could see the very first screening on New Year's Day, because I knew nobody else would get up at that point, and that was the only way I could get in to see it. But it was incredibly popular, and it, whatever, was nominated for 12 or 15 Oscars or something ridiculous. So it was kind of obvious that they were going to win everything, And it wasn't actually until I was actually there, and Henner Sisters was actually nominated for 7, which was unto itself kind of stunning. Oh, I should have told you that too. That unto itself kind of stunning, because amongst the early awards they gave was supporting actress. And Diane Wiest won for that for Hannah and Her Sisters, which didn't surprise me, and I love Diane Wiest. She's a wonderful person as well as a wonderful actress, so I was very excited for her on that front. But then a couple of awards later, Michael Caine won for supporting actor, and I'm going, wait a second, what's going on here? And then a couple of awards later, Woody won for screenplay, and I'm going, uh-oh, I'm in serious trouble. I've got to actually write a speech, and I've got to do it like now.
In the middle of the Oscars ceremony.
But then reality set in, and it was like one platoon after another, and so I then was fine. And surprisingly, Platoon won for best editing. So I was totally relaxed.
You let off the hook.
Yeah.
Just get to go,
no problem.
Got to drink up at that point, right?
Absolutely. Oh, the other thing that you should know about the Oscars is that when you arrive, they pick you up at the airport in a limo, and you're treated like, you know, God's gift to the world, right? When you win an Oscar, you're treated exactly that way. When you don't win an Oscar, you're picked up in sort of like a Volkswagen Bug or something like that. It's like you are of no interest to anybody. The doorman doesn't care. You want to get in a car? All right, get a car. But, yeah, there's a very different way you're treated.
For somebody who, I mean, honestly, if I was you, I would be proud of every single day of my career so far. But what is the proudest moment? What is the highlight you've had so far of your career?
She's tried to ask me this before. And the terrible thing is it floats from one thing to another, because I'm not really good. I don't know why this is, but I'm not really good at being proud of things. So
I know that you're so humble that you don't even people to say that they're like honored to meet you.
Well, actually, the thing I'm proudest of, which has nothing to do with this, is that I was voted as co-captain of my field hockey team at Yale, and that was my co-captain and I were the first female varsity captains in Yale's history. So that's the thing that I'm proudest of. But thank you. That's something I'm actually proud of. Now we're going to do the faux proud things. No, it's not true. I mean, I'm proud of the film Zelig, because that was a situation where when Woody wrote the script for that, he had absolutely no idea what the work was going to be that was entailed, because he's just not a technician. That's not the interest he had, and he just thought it would be a cool idea to insert himself into old footage, but he had no idea what that was going to involve, and I think only Gordon Willis and I knew what we were getting into on that project. So simply finding the shots into which he could be inserted was an art unto itself, because you're having to look at existing footage and figure out where somebody could fit into it and where somebody could fit into it so that nobody else would be looking at that person, because it's kind of like, why would somebody not be noticing that that person is in the shot? So it was challenging on that basis. And then there were all of the technical challenges, which don't exist any longer, which are all handled by computer software, but back in those days you were doing all of this photochemically and you were pulling mats and so forth.
Are you guys familiar with Zelig? Who here has seen it?
God, that's amazing percentage.
I mean, we actually have a clip from Zelig.
Florida, 1 year later. An odd incident occurs at the New York Yankees training camp. Journalists, anxious as always to immortalize the exploits of the great home run hitters, notice a strange new player waiting his turn at bat after Babe Ruth. He is listed on the roster as Lou Zelig, but no one on the team has heard of him. Security guards are called, and he is escorted from the premises. It appears as a small item in the next day's newspaper.
if I could just explain for a split second what you're looking at. The shot of Babe Ruth swinging was not a static shot. They panned with him as he stepped forward. He swung through, and they panned with him as he stepped forward. So it probably panned for about a 15 degrees or so. So we basically had to blow the shot up so that we could hold it static, and we had to steady the shot. So you're having to find horizontals within the frame and verticals within the frame so as to frame by frame steady it, because you didn't have stabilization as a program. You found a vertical and a horizontal within the frame in order to, like, you can see the vertical up there, and you'd find a horizontal here, for example. You know, they had to be well demarcated, like that would be a good horizontal, and you'd line them up in order to get it correct that way. But generally speaking, if you wanted to insert somebody into something, you really didn't want the person's feet to be in the frame, because like in this situation, clearly the lighting was such that he would cast a shadow. So we also had to create the shadow in there. When Babe Ruth comes back and swings again, you see the bat cross his body, so we had to put the bat back in crossing Woody's body. But in addition to that, he had to be shot on a blue screen, and then we had to be matching the lighting, the direction of the lighting, and so forth. We had to be matching what the lens would be doing. We had to guess what the lens was that Babe Ruth was shot with, shoot with the same lens, and have him be slightly soft focus. So that was another factor to it. And then we had to mimic the grain structure of the original so that he looked correct from that perspective. This actually looks better in the film version than it does when you pull it to video, because video messes up contrast and so forth.
And this is very, very low quality.
And this is a very, very low
resolution.
But all of that, those are all amongst the things that we had to concern ourselves with. But also originally in picking the shot, it was also that I was thinking we had a better shot here than if we were to put him elsewhere in the frame, because there was this black, whatever the heck, door behind him, part of the fence behind him, so that there was something that was an easier thing to pull him out against as opposed to the rest of the background.
So what system did you do? You can put the thing back up.
You can play it again if you want to, just so you can see what we were just talking about.
Florida, 1 year later. An odd incident occurs at the New York Yankees training camp. Journalists, anxious as always to immortalize the exploits of the great home run hitters, notice a strange new player waiting his turn at bat after Babe Ruth. He is listed on the roster as Lou Zelig, but no one on the team has heard of him. Security guards are called, and he is escorted from the premises. It appears as a small item in the next day's newspaper.
But that also is, I mean, what we, you can turn down the light. It wasn't all that fascinating, but... But that also was early on in the picture, and once you sold people on a couple of things like that, where that was truly a legitimate thing, then people begin to give you credit for things that you don't necessarily do too. You know, they give you a lot more credit once they've been bought into the fact that yes, that's obviously Babe Ruth, and yes, that's obviously Woody.
And so tell me, like, so this was cut on video, which of course, you know, back then, like, nobody was cutting on video.
Well, Coppola had just done a film called One from the Heart on video, but that was the only thing that had been done, that was the only feature that had been done on video at that point. So yes, we cut on video, and it was a great, I mean, actually, Woody shot two films in a row, or literally back to back that summer. One was Midsummer Night's Sex Comedy, and the other was Zelig, and he said, which one do you want to cut on video, and we'll do the other one on film. And I said, Zelig on video, no question, because among other things, we had a ton of stock footage that we had to go through, and it was a lot easier to get the stock footage on video and to scan it on video, and we cataloged it very, very carefully so that you could, you know, type in a time code and find anything you wanted in seconds. So that was great, but it was a horrible experience. It's a horrible experience because in those days you were cutting onto videotape. Mm-hmm. so that you had the linear problem. You did not have random access, so whenever you cut something, you had to then go back and relay it down, or alternatively, you had to deal with the fact that you had big black moments in between things. So it was dramatic that way, and certainly we were also then waiting for film to come in. Once we had decided what we wanted, we had to then order the film elements. So the first time we screened it, we essentially screened Black Leader with that gentleman, Patrick Horgan, doing the voiceover. We screened Black Leader, and every now and then an image would come up, and basically we screened a radio play. So it took quite a while for that thing to come together.
So at this point, I mean, I have tons of questions, because, I mean, there's so much that I really want to ask you, but I kind of feel like I want to go to the floor. I mean, I think that now you guys have got a pretty good idea of probably so many questions that you want to ask Sandy and Tricia. I kind of want to, like, do this and let you guys take it over. So I'm gonna basically bring my mic to whoever wants to ask questions. I can see Daniel leaning forward, looking like he wants to ask something. Like he's sitting in the front row just so that he can. So can I?
I would say get back to me.
All right. Who's got a? All right.
I probably don't need the mic.
Yeah. Well, we're recording this.
Oh God, not that.
So day in and day out, do you have like a set of rules for yourself, or how do you keep yourself sane every day, going through a movie? And like, do you try to stick to routines, or you know, what are your, do you have a little trick that you have for yourself when you find that you're like having an off day? Or
I don't know what makes you think I keep myself sane. I mean,
lots of coffee.
Yeah, I was gonna say lots of coffee. I would say mostly keeping myself sane is actually, I think it's actually my assistant and my intern. I think talking things down when something comes up that I'm finding problematic, or just asking other people's opinions of things is often part of what keeps me sane. I think also just getting up and walking around or thinking, talking about something else, going to lunch and actually having a conversation about who's going to win the election and whether it's we're actually going to have a President Trump or not.
Well, sometimes we just straight up lose it, because Bree will go out of the room for like an hour or something, and then she'll come back and we're just giggling uncontrollably. And she's like, what happened to you guys? And we're like, I don't know.
But to a certain extent, it is just a matter of being able to get, you know, just step away from it. You can't stay focused for that long, and I do tend to put in long days. I tend to try to finish as much as I can in the course of the day. I really don't like leaving something unfinished, so I don't know whether that answered anything.
Just some answers.
Yeah. Hi.
Hi. Is there anything that you miss about editing on a Steenbeck and the whole Steenbeck process?
That's a great question. I loved editing on a Steenbeck. One of the things about editing on a Steenbeck is that everything isn't instantaneous. So when you're putting something together, even while you're rewinding in order to go back forward again, you're having time to discuss things, with the director frequently. But this is the director over here. The director often would sit on your right. You have time to discuss things when you're going back and forward. You have time to think about other things when you're going back and forward. And also, you get up in between reels rather than just going immediately to the next scene, which among other things means that you get exercise. You're not just sitting in one position all day long. You're not doing the same thing. You're not doing the carpal tunnel syndrome kind of thing. Not that I have that as a problem, but you're not doing things in precisely the same fashion repeatedly. And I think that it's good to have those moments to get away from things. I also do like the physicality of film. I like.
So you were telling me about fixing problems, like we.
Oh yeah, that's gigantic too.
Of errors, you know, that are technical errors and we can't figure out. But when you would have errors, you could like look under the machine and like see the error and fix
it.
Yeah,
when you worked on a mechanical Steenbeck, which I did in the earlier years, it was actually 1981 when I first had a an electronic Steinbeck. But prior to that, you could just look under the hood and figure out what the problem was. You know, oh, it's just a whatever the heck, it's just a belt that slipped, or this particular cog is broken, or whatever it ended up being. You could see what the problem was, and for the most part, you could solve most of them yourself, or you could find something that you could put it together with to fix it. When it became electronic, it was literally they would say to you, I mean, when we were on Zelig, whenever we had a problem, they would frequently say, okay, take the top off of the off of the computer, or the computer element, you know, the CPU, and just touch the various ICs and tell me which one is hot. Oh, if it's that one that's hot, that one's serious. That one we'll have to get you another piece of equipment. Oh, that one we could actually come in and just replace that specific one for you. It was absolutely ridiculous. And with the Steinbeck, it was they would say, oh, if it's 5 volts at this particular place on the circuit board, then that's good news. And you know, it's like, how the heck can you live that way? But it's the same sort of thing that happens now when you get the error messages on the Avid. They often are Greek to me anyway.
And you have to Google them and search and forums and all kinds of great stuff.
And that's one of the things that I'm very, very grateful to having an assistant who has the patience to do all that searching, or for that matter, the technicians, like,
yes,
is Eric somewhere? Eric is somewhere back around here. Eric,
yeah,
is
there's
there.
Eric over there. He's the technician here at Light Iron that spends a lot of time in their room.
Yeah.
We shouldn't say that. Everything works here beautifully at Light Iron.
But that's gigantic. But I think that those are the things that the image quality. But I also did very much enjoy, on Zelig in particular, but on a lot of projects, being involved in the what we then called opticals. In figuring out how to resolve things. I still have that kind of conversation. We just had a conversation the other day with somebody about how we could better match a plate to the foreground that was shot. And it's the same principles, but it's done in a different fashion in video than it was in film.
Thank you.
We got one here.
Were you always confident about your work, or what, like, especially transitioning from AE to editor with Woody Allen, how did you gain that confidence? When did you know? When did you get into that rhythm?
You know, it's so funny, it's so charming and funny for you to ask that question, because I would have thought by now you would have looked at me and said, she's not confident. You know? But, and I don't think of myself as confident, but by the same token, when I saw that notice on the notice board, and it was like, there is a job available, it struck me as sort of the obvious thing you do if there is a job available, is you go over and you knock on the door. It didn't strike me that there was anything that was a matter of confidence about that. It was just a matter of, there's the door, knock on it, see what happens. And peculiarly, I know this is not answering your question, but peculiarly on that project where I was the intern, one of the early things that I was involved in was a Foley session. Do you know what Foleys are? I mean, okay, fine. Do you all know what Foleys are? Okay, great. The first Foley that came up was a boy kicking a can along a sidewalk. I didn't know what Foleys were. This was my first Foley session. A boy kicking a can along the sidewalk. He was a teenage boy, a 13-year-old boy. And the two editors that were involved, the sound editor and the picture editor, were absolutely massive, strong guys, and there's no way they were going to be able to do these Foleys. So they said, you do that one. I'm going, okay. I have to kick a can along a sidewalk and make that look like it's in sync. As that day progressed, the director I was working with, who was a teacher of mine from film school, wonderful woman. She actually was a wonderful script supervisor in her day. She did On the Waterfront, for example, with Kazan and whatever. Terrific woman. Roberta Hodes is her name. And she's a wonderful person, but she was totally panicked that she was going to lose all the time that they had in that day to, this doesn't sound like it's answering your question, but it's getting there. Was she only had an 8-hour day to get all of the Foleys done for an hour and a half film, and that was pretty tight. And she panicked about halfway through the day, and she started yelling at people about how they weren't working fast enough and so forth. So I just said, Roberta, leave the room. I mean, we know what needs to be done. We will get it done. If it's not done by 6 o'clock, then we'll solve that problem then. But right now, let's just keep working. So if you're gonna throw a tantrum out in the hall and come back in. And everybody looked at me like, you know, you're a kid. and Roberta left the room dutifully. And but she knew me. I mean, we were sort of friends apart from my being her intern on this thing. But anyway, so then everybody turned to me like, okay, what do we do next? I said, next loop. You know, like I knew what I was doing. And we just got everything done in the span of time. Again, I think that's sort of a combination of playing sports where you just play to the whistle. You know, you just keep going at it until you've got the job done. If you're behind, you just find a way of catching up because you have to. Or college, for that matter. You know, if you're suddenly put on the spot in a seminar and you have to answer a question that you weren't expecting, you have to think fast. So I don't think I particularly thought about it. Maybe it was just in the moment. I didn't think about it as being daunting. And certainly working with Woody and Ralph, when I was first working with them, they would turn and ask me what I thought of things. And as I'm wont to say, when somebody would ask me a question when I was 23, 24 years old, when I was first starting out, I actually thought they wanted to know honestly what I thought. I didn't realize until much later that they might not want to know what I actually thought, so I told them what I actually thought. And they seemed to appreciate it. They seemed certainly to take it. And they would continue to ask me questions, so I would continue to answer them. And since Ralph kind of bowed out in a fashion on interiors, and therefore it was just Woody and me, and he was clearly as daunted as anybody on this project, which was not his forte, trying to tell a dramatic story as opposed to a comedic story, he would listen to what I had to say, and it became. And I do think that an awful lot of the good of editing or of most filmmaking or most of life is it comes from back and forth as opposed to comes from one person having all the brilliant ideas. And I think that although an awful lot of the stars in the industry might not be the first people to say that, the people who are better at their jobs, the people who really are the geniuses of the industry, are the people who lean on other people and who ask other people's opinion. So
I actually have a question.
Sure.
On that. Obviously, Ralph was your mentor, you know, back in the day, right? Do you have somebody now that you kind of go to when you want advice from somebody, you know, that, like, do you have somebody now that's kind of like a mentor to you? Who do you talk to?
In different categories, it's different people. I mean, not super recently, but one of my best friends at film school was Barry Sonnenfeld, who's a very good cinematographer as well. And when we had problems on September, and Carlo De Palma was having difficulty in getting the look that Woody was after, Woody asked me, you know, what I thought we should do in order to solve that. And I said, I'll call around. And I called Barry, and I asked him how he would have solved this problem. And Barry shot back some ideas to me on how we could get the look that Woody was after. And so I told Woody, and Woody told Carlo that maybe it would be good to give such and such a try. And that's the way we shot it. But there are other people through, I mean, certainly in a mixing realm or in that capacity. Lee Dichter is a very close friend of mine now, and when we were working on Zelig, we were trying to find how to make the sound old, apart from the fact that we were using old microphones, we were trying to find what else would lead you to believe that you were hearing sound that had been recorded 50 years ago at that point. And Lee had a lot of great ideas, so Lee became a mentor in that respect. And also, I always in mixes would sit beside the mixer, not just sit back as though I was, you know, entitled in some fashion, but sit beside the mixer so that I would learn something. I mean, ask him how he was doing that, why he was doing whatever he was doing. And Lee has a lot of great things that he does. It's like he'll roll the EQ on a given line so as to get a syllable a little bit brighter. And most people don't do that sort of thing. But there would be things that I would pick up from various people. So it depends on the category. There are lab people that I've been close to, people in video. John Dowdell is a colorist that I've worked with a lot from back on Annie Hall.
Actually, a bunch of people from here have possibly met John Dowdell because we did a colorist masterclass with him last year.
Oh, seriously?
Yeah.
No, he was fantastic. He was the guy who actually did the split screen for us in Annie Hall when you see Woody's family and Diane's family in the same shot, but. He goes back, I mean, we go back that far together, and when we were doing
Zelig.
He's
actually my mentor.
Oh, seriously? I never knew that. Oh, well, he's fantastic. I love him. But he also, on Zelig, when we first saw it, after we finished it in film and made it look the way we wanted it to look, we sent it to the studio, which was the normal thing that you did back in those days, to have them make a video version of it. And they took out all of everything that we had done to make it look old. And I couldn't believe it. So John and I then went back over it and did the equivalent things in video, but they were different things because video is a very different medium from film in terms of contrast, in terms of color is a factor as well, but that was mostly black and white. But it was a challenge to do these same effects in video. So he's another mentor. Dick Hyman is somebody that I've worked with an awful lot in music, and he's wonderful in all respects. He's a musicologist as well as being fantastic as an arranger. Bless you. But he's extraordinary. So I've often called on him for things as well. But I call on my assistants also on assistants that I've worked with over the years. If I've got questions about anything technical, I usually ask them their opinions. And other people and assistants that I've worked with who have since been nominated for Academy Awards and so forth, I'll ask them questions too. It's been, you know, it varies. I always feel that if you don't learn something new from each person you meet, then it's your fault, you know, so.
Well, you've been waiting. All right.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Hi, Sandy.
Hi.
So I'm just kind of curious to see, like, when you're starting off with scene,
mm-hmm.
just like your approach, because I think, you know, especially nowadays with like the, you know, certain filmmakers who kind of go and make their own videos where they kind of break down the editing. Like, I remember watching a video recently where they kind of break down editing, like how it works. I think maybe the first and second example was from Hannah and her sisters. So I thought, I might have seen that video. And also a recent video, which I did not watch. I'm very ill-prepared tonight. But it was saying how, like, Walter Murch introduced, like, a certain concept where it's, like, you cut on...
Oh, on
like
the blank.
Blank.
Yeah,
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 and
yeah.
Then people were putting it to test. And I obviously didn't watch, so I couldn't comment further, but... You know, with all these videos where people kind of break down what works in editing and like the magic behind it, I just kind of want to hear you, like, your approach, just like when I sit down and I finally get to it, this is like what I'm trying to do or what I'm, you know, I just want to.
You mean like how do you know where to cut?
In a sense, or like, all right, how do I get to the scene? Maybe, you know, maybe you're not thinking like, well, this is what, I, you know, this is what I want the audience to think, or, you know, where you get to like the technical, even though editing is very emotional, and there's always like this kind of clash between like what works or what isn't going to work technically as opposed to like emotionally.
It's a very interesting question. I do feel I I am not at all like Walter Murch in that respect. I adore him. He's a lovely guy. And but I am not that type of cerebral or that type of I don't go through that kind of a filter when I'm editing something. Honestly, most of it is how I feel as I'm working on something. There's a certain there's a certain aspect to it where I'm looking at the material and saying, oh, I definitely want to be in this angle for this moment because of something about the performance at that point, or I feel that this is a moment where I want to be close, or this is a moment where I want to be wide for whatever reason. But in all honesty, it will sound ridiculous, but I feel as though I'm part of the scene when I'm cutting it. I feel as though I'm one of the characters in the scene. And I, it's, in a manner of speaking, I was talking with Katie about this the other day, because when I worked with Sven Nyquist as one of our, as a cinematographer on several of Woody's movies, we used to talk about, because I used to love operating as well, and we used to talk about how when you're operating the camera, you have to feel as though you're one of the characters in the scene, because you have to feel as though you're able to anticipate what the person is going to do, whether the person is going to move or whether the person is going to, whether this is a moment where you want to be closer or whether this is, or whatever it ends up being, but you're having to feel as though you're part of the scene. And I feel very much the same way about editing. And I know that that's not really, that sounds like a cop-out on some level, but it's the truth of the way I experience it. I'm sorry.
You have such an amazing body of work. And I don't know if I was in your position, where do you want to go now? Like, do you have a future project that, if it mean maybe not even editing, like, do you want to, is there something else that you're, that you haven't done? Like, it just seems like you've done it all, but is there something that you personally want to do and that you're looking forward to doing?
The terrible thing is, the immediate thing that came to mind was, I really would like to do whitewater rafting on the Colorado River. But that probably wasn't what you were going for.
No, I was thinking more in terms of creativity, but
no. that's a really tough question, because there is a part of me there are a couple of things. There's a part of me that was always intrigued by directing. There were specific personal reasons why that wasn't a good decision for me at a certain point in my life. But I guess there's some faintest of thoughts that might, if that ever presented itself with a project that seemed to be of interest to me. But I actually, there's another totally insane thing that absolutely, I can't imagine anybody else being fascinated by this. But after the 2000 election, I so much wanted to do something about the Electoral College. I wanted to do a documentary about the Electoral College, because I think that the Electoral College should not, it's not that I think that the Electoral College per se is the problem. I think that the problem is the way the votes are apportioned per state. I think that winner take all should not be the way the votes are apportioned. And as a history major, I know perfectly well that they weren't apportioned that way, or they were not intended to be apportioned that way by the founding fathers, that it was only when, is this really getting boring? Because I'll shut up.
No, not at all.
Because when Adams beat Jefferson, because the votes in Virginia, which is where Jefferson was from as opposed to Massachusetts, where Adams was from, the votes in Virginia were apportioned district by district, as opposed to winner take all. It was perceived by Jefferson and the other Virginians that had they been apportioned winner take all, then Jefferson would have won. So Virginia then decided to apportion their votes winner take all. Massachusetts responded in kind. but it wasn't until 1832, and for those of you who are counting, that's 32 years down the line, it wasn't like instantaneously, it wasn't until 1832 that that became a widespread situation. So it wasn't as though people at the outset felt that that was important. And if you had, and I actually did study it after the 2000 election, if votes had been apportioned per state, proportional to the popular vote within each state independently, there would only have been three states that would have gone dramatically in one direction or another, and those would have been California, New York, and Texas, and then District of Columbia as well. But most states, it was something like 26 or 27 states, would have been split by one vote, one in either direction, and the remaining would have been split by two votes. So basically, this is not a red and blue country. Basically, this is a purple country, and I think the fact that people made such a big point about talking about red and blue has created a lot of the polarity that exists at the moment and the acrimony that exists at the moment. So I think if one could possibly get it to a point where it was apportioned winner-take-all within states, I can tell you in 2000 it would not have been won by Gore under those circumstances. It would have, he would have missed by one vote, and it would have gone to the House of Representatives, so Bush would have won anyway, but because of Nader. But I think that that would be something that, that if I could bring myself actually to undertake it, or I could bring anybody to fund me on doing that, I would try to fight for that, because I think that that would matter. And I'd like to do something that actually mattered as opposed to the stuff that I do. But in any case, so that was of some significance to me. But I have peculiar side issues that interest me.
You should write
as
a book.
As my assistants would tell me, I should write a book about what? Thank you, but I don't know what it would be about.
Hi.
Hi.
So I recently graduated from film school. And I guess what I'd like to ask, is there some sort of piece of advice that you wish someone else gave you when you just kind of started out? Or the best piece of advice you can come up with right now?
Run.
When I first, well, there's that aspect to it too. It's really tough, because when I first started out, I wasn't intending to get involved in film. That was Katie was not joking when she said I would have been a teacher. And when I was in high school, I thought I wanted to be a teacher. But I did take teacher prep in college, and I discovered that I was absolutely terrified in front of a group this size. And we were thankfully in team teaching situations, so I would take what I used to call the back row boys. I would take the kids who tended to get into trouble and try to teach them while the other person took the bulk of the class. And I enjoyed that. It was a fun kind of challenge, and I usually could communicate with folks who were running away from learning. So I found that exciting. But it wasn't really an occupation. And my father contracted cancer the moment I got to college, so I felt as though I was really majoring in cancer rather than devising any sort of a curriculum for myself. So I came out of college without any clue as to what I was going to do. It was my mom who suggested film, just because these are ridiculously long stories, but because I had written something in high school about film as a medium of propaganda, because I had seen a double bill of Triumph of the Will, which is an extraordinary documentary by Leni Riefenstahl on the Nuremberg rallies in 1934 in Nazi Germany, that gets you so revved up about how fantastic Hitler is, and you can well imagine it's like going to a great concert, a pep rally, like a bonfire pep rally, something where you'd really get excited about something, you'd really get revved up, but right on the heels of seeing this, where you're actually, of course, I was like 15, 16 when I saw this, so I knew who Hitler was, but I didn't really know how horrific what he had done was, because concentration camps were simply, it was simply a word, you didn't really grasp it. 6 million Jews were killed, it was an unfathomable word. But the next film that came up was called Ali and Renee's Night and Fog, which showed you what had happened in the concentration camp, and you'd see mounds of hair that went on for like miles. You know, I mean, not probably miles, but the size of a football field, and you'd see what you're dealing with, and you'd see bodies bulldozed into graves, and you'd say, God, it's stunning what people were led to by virtue of what they saw on film. And it made me think about things in terms of what I was seeing on television and so forth, and saying, all you see on television were white people, and you never saw women in any position of authority, and you never saw blacks or people of color of any sort in any position other than something demeaning. And obviously that's the message we are being told. What's the matter with this world? Something should be changed. And so that was what made her think that I might be interested in doing it. And I, as I say, took a shot at film school at NYU and fell into this job. But because my father had died and I had to help support my mom, if I got a job, even if it was $69 a week, I would be helping to support my mom. And so I very much got caught up in it. It's hard once you get into anything to pull yourself out of it and to go into an entirely different realm. So I don't know whether that answers anything. What advice would I mean, you could say, what advice do I wish I had been given at that point? It might have been, go ahead and do something that you really dream of doing as opposed to doing something because it's the first thing you fell into. I don't know whether that would have been the best advice, but I would like to have been able to take that advice. I would like to have done the things that I actually wanted to do. But the other side of it is, the advice I would give somebody now would be the sort of thing of, if you see a notice on the notice board, knock on the door. Don't second guess yourself. Don't question whether or not you're qualified enough for something. Go to people, tell them honestly what you've done before, but also tell them honestly that you will try anything, and you're willing to put in the hours, and you're willing to put in the effort. And most people respond to that. Most people respond to somebody who is simply intelligent and willing and inclined to be helpful and is polite and interested in what they're interested in. And generally, whatever you do, do the best you can with it. I know this is sounding very much like what your mom probably told you when you were growing up, but I'm a mom, what can I tell you? But do the best you can with it, and chances are people will notice that, and they'll be very grateful for what you did, and you'll probably be mentioned to somebody else, and you'll discover that the networking actually happens when you're not looking. So I don't know whether that's helpful or not, and I would say in terms of editing per se, if you're thinking editing per se, definitely learn the hardware, definitely learn the software, definitely, but also learn as much as you can about what's going on under the hood, because the turnover is so rapid. It's not as though the existing software is going to be what you're even going to be facing next year. There's going to be an entirely different version of it, so you might as well learn as much as you can about how things are, how, I don't mean to say you necessarily have to write code yourself, but I mean, as much as you can about what is going on with computers, because that's definitely very critical. But try to keep up as much as you can on news and what else is happening in the world and other things that are innovations that are coming out. Because I mean, even something I was hearing yesterday was fascinating. I don't know whether in any way pertains to film, but something about how people were taking prescription pills or non-prescription pills that people can no longer use or that are expired in terms of their efficacy, and they're now turning them into energy. You know, is that a kind of stunning thing or what? I mean, you know, pay attention to this stuff when it comes up, because you don't necessarily know where the next job or the next industry is coming from, and it's worth it to just sort of pay attention. don't know whether any of that is of any use, but I hope some of it.
Wise words. So we are going to, obviously, I mean, Sandy works here. So, you know, we're going to kind of move it out and have some beers and that and let you guys, you know, actually meet her and catch her. I'm sure she'll stick around until you scare her off. So, but I really, you know, obviously want to thank you all for coming. This is actually, you know, obviously this, as you know, is a fundraising event for the Blue Collar Post Collective. And I want to thank all of you very, very much from the bottom of my heart for supporting us and what we're doing. The money that's raised tonight goes towards the Professional Development Accessibility Program, which, of course, and applications for Sight, Sound, and Story close tomorrow. But that fund is actually really, you know, that's something really close to my heart. That is, you know, something that I came up with because there was a young intern last year who had a paper accepted into the SMPD conference, which is an amazingly huge, incredible achievement for anybody, let alone an intern. And he was part of the BCPC, and I was part of the SMPD committee, so I knew that I saw his name there, and I got in touch with him over Facebook to congratulate him, and he told me that, unfortunately, he couldn't afford to attend the conference that he was, you know, invited to speak at. And I knew at that moment that something had to be done about that, that could never happen again, and that as a community, we're all about supporting each other, so we could all just damn well pitch in and make sure that doesn't happen again. So that's what the Professional Development Accessibility Program is about. And, you know, it's about everyone pitching in, whether it's these fundraisers, whether it's the donations and the raffles and all that sort of thing, coming together and making sure that low-income people in post can actually have the same opportunity as the rest of us to go to NAB and Sight, Sound, and Story and Edit Fest and all that sort of thing. So so I want to thank you all from the bottom of my heart for this, helping out with this fundraiser tonight. And of course, we need to thank Sandy.
Well, thank you, but I really want to thank you for having patience with me on all these idiosyncratic aspects of my interests. It's very kind of you.
I told you she's cool, right? She's really cool. And Tricia, of course, you know, Sandy's right hand.
My right hand. And my left hand is back in the back. That's Bree. Back.
A couple more. Just thank you, Katie. Thank you, Manhattan Edit Workshop, for filming tonight's event. Manhattan Edit Workshop is putting on the Sight, Sound, and Story, which is like tonight's event. Many wonderful people will be sharing their stories about post-production, from editing, VFX, everything across the board. So talk to us more about it.
Cool.
And thank you for coming.
Thanks, guys.